Come on and lift up the name of Jesus. Come on and lift up the name of Jesus. He is the great I am. If he's everything you need him to be, if you love him this morning, just give him a wave offering. Say, thank you, Lord. Amen. In the deaf ministry, they do like this, I believe. Amen. Amen. If you love the Lord because he first loved you, then give God praise. If you loved him because you were unlovable, then praise him. If he's looked beyond your faults and saw your need, then he has deserved a worthy praise. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord, and we are just, again, excited to be home again. I have several homes that I like to come to, and Mount Nebo is one of them. So I can't believe Brother Man asked me for a bio, but I'll deal with him later. But it's always good to be back at Mount Nebo and to be entrusted by Pastor Jonathan Weaver with his sheep. I don't take it lightly, and I consider him a big brother in the ministry and a very dear friend of mine. He is an authentic man of God, and you can't find that everywhere. Come on, praise God for your pastor. Amen. I was blessed to give Lady Pam Weaver a hug this morning, and we thank God for her and for all the missionaries who are with Pastor in Rwanda. We pray their work would be fruitful and that they would come back home to us safely. Amen. We thank God for this marvelous choir, Chosen Generation. Amen. And don't tell anybody after the benediction, but Minister Alfonso Jones is one of my favorite ministers of music in the area. But don't tell other ones that. Amen. Amen. He is just a wonderful man of God. To these preachers behind me and to all the officers, we greet you in the joy of Jesus. We thank God for the greatest armor bearer that God could give me for 28 years. On the 29th of this month, we will be celebrating 28 years of wonderful marriage. Amen. Amen. I don't know how other people do it, but I've been happy for 29 years. Amen. Tell the truth. Amen. God blessed me with the very best, and I thank God for him. Today, let's go back to the Word of God. And I want to just highlight a very familiar passage. You don't even have to turn to it. Matthew 6 and 33 is our focus today. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything will be added unto you. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything will be given unto you. As we begin to minister under the subject, A Recipe for Reaping, let us pray. Gracious God, we stand here again. God, we are so grateful for how you blessed in the first service. And we ask, God, that you would renew the strength of this your vessel, that I might pour out through the power of the Holy Spirit your words and not mine. God, fill me up once again, that your people would hear from you. And then when we go down from this place, our lives will never be the same again. So God, hide me, strengthen me, speak to me, work with me, mold me, shape me into the vessel you desire for me to be, and all glory will go unto you and not me. In Jesus' name I do pray and believe. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. A recipe for reaping. We all hit challenges on our spiritual journey and get stuck or stalled from time to time. For some, it's like a flat tire that could easily be fixed. But for some of us, it's like a full-blown engine and runs us off the road. Sometimes, we don't know what's wrong with us. When life's challenges come, and they do, we have to deal with them rather than follow the super saint syndrome that we have been duped into believing that the character of a strong disciple is not to have any problems. We live in a world where everything goes, and reality TV is our inspiration Oprah and Ayanna Van Zandt are our spiritual advisors, and the church is just something that we do on Sundays. And I'm talking to Christians now. It's more of me and less of God. We're still saved now, but we're saved without power. We're saved without prayer. We're saved without a cost. We're saved without sharing. We're saved without service, and we're saved without reaping. I want to suggest this morning that we have to start walking as kingdom disciples, and that we are, and stop following a Christianity light. That's a separate sermon series altogether. But we're duped into believing that this walk is just something easy, that we just glide through life with no cost and no penalty in our walk with God. Our text this morning backs me up. For coming to the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is exhorting his disciples to lay up treasures in heaven by helping others. The text tells us to keep our eyes good, guarding what they allow to influence the inner man or the inner woman. If they make God their master, they would not be able to serve another master. The question becomes, if we do what Jesus says, what about the future here on earth? If we lay up treasures in heaven instead of here on earth, how will we provide for our future? Where will our physical necessities like food and drink and clothes come from? How in this economy can we keep from worrying about such things? I like the Message version of Matthew 6, 31 and 33. Listen to this. It says, what I'm trying to do here is to get you to relax, to not be so preoccupied with getting so you can respond to God's giving. I think that's real good. Let me say that again. What I'm trying to get you to do here is to relax and to not be so preoccupied with getting so you can respond to God's giving. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things. But you and me who know God, we should know how God works. Steep your life in God reality, God initiative, and God provisions. Don't worry about missing out on anything. You'll find all of your everyday human concerns will be met. Jesus gives us in our text a recipe for reaping. A recipe for reaping for disciples seeking first the kingdom. And preachers, I found three things in this text that I want to share with you. The first thing we see in the text is a precaution. Take no thought. Don't be anxious. See, worry is like a rocking chair. You spend a lot of energy going nowhere. A lot of people in our society spend a lot of times worrying about things they have absolutely no control over. What other people think about them, the rise and fall of the economy, global warming and ISIS attacks, catching a disease like Ebola. See, for me, I don't care what they come out with. The bottom line is it's win-win for me. Whether I'm here or whether I die and go to be with the Lord, it's win-win. We worry about getting older and who's going to take care of us. And sometimes we even worry about the weather. We worry about every possible circumstance. In fact, worry and anxiety can break down the human body, increasing high risks of cancer, high blood pressure, diabetes. Most sicknesses can be traced back to an overabundance of worry. Verse 25 through 34 of the sixth chapter is what I personally call, preachers, a recipe for reaping from the counsel of worry and anxiety. We find in these verses God's counsel for us spelled out in eight practical commands that will meet all of our needs. Verse 25 says, don't worry about necessity. It says concentrate on your life and body. They are what is important. Verse 26 says don't worry about food and shelter. Verse 27 says don't worry about your stature. 28 and 30 says don't worry about clothes. 31 and 32 say don't worry about food, drink, or clothes. Don't worry, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything will be added unto you. In other words, verse 34 says, don't worry about tomorrow, live one day at a time. The believer is not to worry about the necessities of life. The word says, take no thought. That means don't worry, don't be anxious, don't be overly concerned. Jesus is not suggesting that we don't prepare for life or that we become lazy or shiftless, but what he is talking about is leave it in Jesus' hands. We must look after, yes, our personal responsibility. You have to work in order to eat. And the reality is we're supposed to work extra in order to have enough to give others. Ephesians 4 and 38, unless you think I make that up. We have a choice. We can carry the world on our shoulders, or we can say, I'm your child, Lord. I don't have to worry. Philippians 4 and 6 says, do not be anxious for anything, but everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Make your requests known unto God, and the peace of God will keep your hearts and your minds. The second thing we see in the text is a provision. A provision. God will supply all your needs. What we're talking about is being preoccupied with material possessions and the luxuries of this world. We are not to be found groping for more and more and hoarding more and more. We don't need to be so wrapped up in securing things that we become anxious and disturbed and stressed out and sleepless and short-tempered and mean, yes, mean. When we try to keep up with the Joneses and we can't, then we become mean, then we begin to hate, and then we become to hate on other people. Jesus is talking about being so consumed with getting the things that we don't need that we have little thought of God and what God wants to give to us. Y'all real quiet, y'all all right? Y'all all right this morning? See, when we focus on getting or act desperate for more, we are revealing to God our lack of trust in him. Living sumptuously every day and extravagantly at ease and in luxury in the midst of a needy and starving world is sin. Now, some of you, I know, you like the preachers of L.A., and you like the prosperity gospel that says otherwise, but it's still sin. Okay, I'm going to turn to this side because this side didn't like that. Why is that sin? Do we really need a 15,000 square foot house for two people to live in? Does one person need a Hummer, a Bentley, two Mercedes, a Range Rover, and a Bugatti? I see y'all don't know nothing about that, so I'm gonna come down your street. Do we need 12 pair of red shoes, sisters? And don't holler, brothers, do we need 25 ties? The reality of it is, it's sinful because there are people with no shoes, no transportation, no red shoes, and no ties. Food, clothing, and shelter are the necessities of life, and it is not wrong to work for these things, nor to secure some things for our future. But what's wrong is ignoring and neglecting God while we work. Working day and night and then worrying about how to keep what we got, because we got to have more, so we worry about how we gonna keep it, and if we keep keeping up with the Joneses, then the bank gonna come to get what we got. Never being satisfied with the necessities, coveting to have more and more, to have bigger and better and bigger, to keep up with the next person, neglecting the needs of others while they have needs and we continue to try to get more. The truth of the matter is, some people got everything and they're miserable. It's not about the things we have, but it's about who has us. A person can only eat and wear so much at a time. Enough is enough, and more than enough is too much, and after a while it's simply greed. Life means more than just things. Materialism can enslave us to such a degree that it controls our very lives. In order to get and possess more, spouses argue and fight. The number one reason spouses argue and fight is over money. I ain't gonna get no help today. The number one reason for divorce is over things and over money. And tell me if I'm not telling the truth, but nasty divorces are over things. See, I ain't gonna get no help. It's all right. It's all right. People steal to get more. Employers hoard and employees crave. Children pout today. Now that's our fault. Come on now, that's our fault, parents. If they can't get a 225 pair of LeBron James, their lip is poked out. When some of us grew up, we were glad to have Jeepers. And they were white. There wasn't no colors. Wasn't no color Jordans with leather and patent leather on them. You give your child some Jeepers and see if their lip ain't hanging down here. We have gotten so accustomed to things. But James 4 and 1 and 3 says, what causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within? You desire, but you do not have, so you kill. You covet what you cannot get, what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. We are better in accordance with the word of God. I'm in the text, it says, than the birds. God is the creator of the birds, but he is the father of believers. God is the creator of the birds, but he is the father of believers. And we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. When we don't seek first the kingdom of God, we focus on the things of the world, we become like the world, coveted of what others have and not content. We're not wise as the birds. We are backsliders who have forgotten what Christ said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. We don't have to panic. No matter what the need is, we are valuable, the text says, to God. The third thing, and then I'll close, we see in the text is a procedure. And the procedure is, put God's kingdom first, and everything will be added. This is the essence of the Christian message. The Christian way of life is not only different from other religions, it is essentially different because we seek first the kingdom, which begins in the heart. Because look up a little bit in the chapter, in verse 21, it says, because where your treasure is, there where your heart is. Means living a kingdom life is not a surface thing. The heart is the very center of our life and our being, and the change comes from deep within. And then you see the text uses the analogy of the eye in verse 22. The eye is the lamp of the body, and if your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. We can't just go everywhere. All right, this side really not liking me today. We can't look at everything. Young people, we can't look at everything. Oh, I need to go up in there. We can't look at certain pornographic stuff? We can't go to certain movies. We can't read everything. Talk about the radio too, the brother says. We can't listen to any kind of music. Because what we take in the eye, the text says it comes out in light in the body. You can't look at darkness and expect light to come out. Okay, all right. Our eyes are the center of every fiber of our being. We are blinded by our own sin and the sins of the world when we look at things we shouldn't. Without repenting, our hearts are being the seat of our soul, replays the thing over and over again. You ever notice when you look at something or listen to something that you should not have? You ever notice you can't get it out your mind? It got real quiet on that one. Jesus put great emphasis on first the heart and the eye to give us a pictorial image of what humanity is. We can't add 1 minute to our life. Worry is senseless. So don't concentrate your mind and your heart on your effort on measuring up to the world's expectation. Let us concentrate and focus upon God and his righteousness. Consider the lilies. You know, when I read this text, preachers, I read it 100 times. But when I read the text, it said, consider the lilies. They grow from deep roots. And the roots are where they belong in the soil to receive nourishment. The roots of the believers are not to be in the material things of the earth. In order to receive our nourishment and fulfill our purpose on earth as believers, we are to put our roots where they belong in God and his righteousness. See, the lilies don't adorn themselves, they just know they're beautiful. Because it comes naturally. See, the lilies don't go to Burlington or Macy's for outfit. The lilies don't go to the Giant or the Safeway for snacks and dinner so they can grow. The lilies don't go and get made makeup and get made up to be beautiful. The lily knows she's a lily, and the Bible says she's beautiful, so she's just a lily. So she doesn't worry about other things. The birds fly in the air because they're carefree. They were made to fly. The grass blows back and forth until it's cut, and then it grows back again. Lilies don't adorn themselves. They just say, I'm a lily. So you can run past them. It don't matter if you got a cute outfit on. The lilies don't care because they're happy being a lily. See, we have to understand who we are in God. So if I'm a lily, and I know I'm a lily, because God said I'm a lily, I'm just a lily. I might cry, but I'm still a lily. I might be beat up, but I'm still a lily. It says the lilies don't adorn themselves. Their beauty comes naturally. So when I act like who I was created to be, I'm just being who I is because that's what God created me to be. So I don't have to hate you. I don't have to hate you because I'm just being me. Let me see if I can help somebody. See, we would fight less if we understood that whatever we are because God created us that way. So let's just say, hypothetically, you're a rose and you're a carnation. I'm a lily. I can't hate you for being a rose. I can't hate you for being a carnation. But you shouldn't hate me for being a lily. If you think lilies are prettier than roses and carnations, that's in the eye of the beholder. I'm a lily, and I think I look better than the carnation and the rose. See, when we understand who we are and when we understand that God created us just like we are, we don't have to hate or act like anybody else. We don't have to try to copy anybody else. I don't normally sweat and spit all the time. This is just who I am. I'm not trying to be Pastor Weaver. I'm not trying to be Bishop so-and-so and so-and-so. I'm not trying to be nobody because I'm a preaching lily. And I understand that that's my job, is to be a lily and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Somebody said, you're always happy all the time. I'm happy because even if I'm broke, I'm still a lily. I'm happy because if my children don't do what we think they should do, I'm still a lily. If I get fired, I'm a lily. Come on, somebody. If they come and take my house, I'm just a lily without a house. If they repo the car, I'm a lily taking the bus. See, when you understand who you are and seek ye first the kingdom of God, it said everything will be added unto me. We don't need another outfit. Well, let me go this way. We don't need another outfit. We don't need another pair of shoes. We don't need another tie. But when we labor after God and the things of God, what shall we reap? We will reap the things of God. The recipe for reaping is a precaution, a provision, and a procedure. And what shall we reap? We will reap a greater anointing. We will reap a new church. I'm not talking about a building. I'm talking about a people. We will reap greater ministry. We will reap greater servanthood. We will reap a place where everyone can make a difference, where no one stands alone, where we have authentic relationships, where you can come as you are but not stay as you are. If we seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, this is a place where hurting people will help one another, a place where if I'm celebrated, you're celebrated. When we seek first the kingdom of God, when one hurts, everybody hurts. We become externally focused and not internally focused. We become the type of church when the community has a need, they say, let's go over to Greater Mount Nebo AME Church. When we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, marriages will be restored. Wayward children will come back home. People will find love the second time around. Yes, they will. And where people can find God again, where we serve one another in humility and grace and mercy, a place where what I lack, I can find in you. And when I need you, you are there for me. And you don't talk about me behind my back because I ask you to help me. You will say, my sister, God's grace is sufficient for you. Because one day when I'm down, I may call upon you to help me. When I seek first the kingdom of God, it's not about what I think, but it's all about what his word says that I should do. When, oh, I feel like preaching now. When I seek first the kingdom of God, he gives me the answers to the problem. When I seek God, when I seek his kingdom, he tells me what is best not for me, but what is best for the kingdom. And no matter what I go through, even if it's difficult, I have to go through it because my life is not about me, but my life is about the kingdom. I'm here on direct assignment, and my assignment is to do what God has asked me to do. And I don't know about you, but one glad morning, when this life is over and I stand before God, I want him to say that I did what he asked me to do. Even when I didn't have anything, I did what he asked me to do. They talked about me, but I can say, yes, Lord. I might have cried a little bit. I might have had a momentary pity party, but I put one foot in front of the other and did what you asked me to do. That's what it means to reap. I will reap if I faint not, because it really doesn't matter what other people think. This is not a popularity contest. The only person I care about is what does the King of Kings and Lord of Lords think of what I'm doing. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and everything that you're asking for will be given unto you. But you can't step into the eternal presence of God willy-nilly in any old kind of way. We ask God to do things. We haven't read our Bible. I'm gonna look down at the speaker. We haven't read our Bible. We haven't prayed. We don't come to church on a regular basis. And then we expect God, yes we do, to be a cosmic bellhop and to give us whatever our little hearts desire. But seek ye first through the power of his word. Seek ye first by bending knee. Seek ye first by singing the songs of Zion. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness in everything. I said everything. Everything will be added unto you. Hallelujah. 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 Seek ye first the kingdom of God in everything. Everything will be added unto you. I'm not promising that it will come on tomorrow, but in God's own time, your change will come. Some of us, God is waiting on us to come back to him. We've tried it our way, and it didn't work. We tried it Pookie's way, and that didn't work either. We tried Mama and Mem's way, and that didn't work. But seek ye first the kingdom of God, and I promise you that everything that you desire, if it's in line with the will of God, will be added unto you. Let me close with saying this. Sit. Let me close with this. Is that we have to understand that God is never late. So if it appears that God is taking a long time, don't look at it like God's taking a long time. Well, preacher, what am I supposed to do? Look at it like God sees me, the lily, you remember. He knows I have need of food, clothes, and shelter. He's making provisions while I'm waiting. God never slumbers nor sleeps. If God is taking a while, let me give you this for free, and then one of y'all gonna have to do the invitation. Is when God takes a long time, that means the greater the blessing. Let me help you with that. Is Satan only messes with those who are a threat to the kingdom. So if you get everything you want when you want, or if you just are so blessed that nothing takes a while for you, I question whether you're really doing anything for the kingdom. Uh-oh. Let me go. They didn't like that. Is that God takes longer for those he trusts. Because it's in the waiting that we learn more about who God is. It's in the waiting where we turn to the word. It's in the waiting where we learn how to pray. It's in the waiting where God can see if he can trust us with greater. Many of us are not ready for greater. Look, I'm silent. Many of us want greater, but we're not ready for greater. Because greater requires more sacrifice. I'm finished. Y'all make a preacher preach. But I want you to get that in your spirit. If you seek his kingdom first, the Bible says everything will be added unto you, but it will be added in God's timing, when you're ready to receive it, and when in the sovereignty of his kingdom, everything is in place for you to walk through it and to exercise it. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. As we stand all over the church, the doors of the church are open. Reverend Foster is I pumped her up for a reason. Because as you can tell, she's just that amazing. And I just praise God for the gift of God in her, teaching us about precaution and provision and procedure. We ought not be worried. Why? Because God's got it all. All we have to do is follow the process, follow the procedure. That's it. That's the recipe. It's that simple that we can teach and show the world a far more excellent way. And why don't we have to worry? Because Jesus has already paid it all. Our own recipes have failed and we have bore the consequences of our trying it our own way. But guess what? Jesus, in his sacrifice, said, don't worry about all that. I got all that. However, if you don't have Jesus, then we need to go back and get that first. You can't work the recipe without Jesus. So now the doors of the church are open. Is there one today who may not know Jesus Christ for themselves, and or you may not have a church home? Is there one today? Come to Christ. Is there one? One more time. Is there one here today? The invitation to accept Jesus Christ is open. And we offer Christ to you so that you can work this recipe and reap the blessing that God has for you. We offer to you, my brother, and we offer to you, my sister. Because he will give you brand new life and life abundantly. Oh, come on. Come on. Is there one today? Come on. To Christ. Father, we thank you for the word that has gone forth. We thank you for the servant, the messenger who brought the word. And we thank you, Lord God, in advance for the fruit of the word. Because, Lord God, we know that this teaching that you have for us in this word will manifest itself over time. And so we thank you, Lord God, that we can nourish on the fruit not just today, but the day after today, and the day after the day after today. That it might provide nourishment so that we can be the lilies that you have called us to be. Thank you, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And now I want you to really praise the Lord because it's giving time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.